Hi, and thanks everyone for attending. My name is Andre Azzolini, and today we'll be talking about the experience I had at Broadleaf Commerce in converting our previous version 2.0 GWT-based admin to the 3.0 admin, which is based on Spring Web MVC. So to start off, I'd like to just give a little bit of background on me and Broadleaf. So I'm a graduate from the computer science program at the University of Texas at Austin. After that, I joined Credera, which is a consulting company that was responsible for incubating Broadleaf. And then when Broadleaf officially became its own company, I joined, which was in October of 2011. So Broadleaf is an open source e-commerce framework built directly on top of Spring. Before we had a name for Broadleaf, we were, you know, referring to ourselves as Spring Commerce. We're highly extensible and scalable. That's one of our main focus points. We are very well architected, we think, and can prove with some of our white papers on scalabilities and things like that. We're used by small, medium, and large businesses alike, ranging from very small clients like Pecan Company out of San Saba, Texas, to more medium-sized clients such as Vology and large-scale businesses like Pet Boys. So the agenda for today is I'm going to go ahead and show a demo of our version 3 admin. And the main reason for this is just to kind of give a little bit of context for the talk. So we'll be covering some of the components that were built to replace certain GWT components like list grids, and it'll help to have a visual idea of what that looks like. We'll talk about the migration considerations that we had when deciding whether or not to proceed with this project. Which we obviously did, so we'll also cover the new approach, the new stack that we're on, things like that. Then we'll go ahead and talk about building one of the replacement components, the list grid, and we'll wrap up the day by highlighting a couple of interesting Spring MVC features that we used and a Q&A at the very end. So let's go ahead and dive into the demo here. So very simple, you know, login screen, nothing too special here. But we'll go ahead and log in. And right off the bat, I'd like to just, you know, look at the nav. So this is completely data-driven from the database, you know, controlling which sections go in which modules, what order, what URL each link points to. And by doing that, we make it really easy to configure, you know, you want to add in a new section, sure, that's just one database row, and then you just map that to the custom controller that you have. Or if you want to override one of the sections that we provide to go to a different URL or anything like that, you're absolutely able to do so. So the list grid component that we're talking about, you can kind of see here in this area, which is very simply a list of records, right? And it's very generic. In fact, any of our default views utilize this list grid. And again, just to form that basis, I'd like to just point out a few features of this list grid, right? So you can resize columns. You can filter on different types. So this filter here would be a lookup to pick a category, whereas this one would be, you know, typing in a pattern that would match the URL. There are different actions that happen per list grid. So this list grid, if I click here, nothing happens because these rows aren't selectable. You have to click on this link, for example. And then here, we're seeing an entity form, right? So all of our default managed entities don't have any custom code. They're, well, nothing except for the very specialized ones, but basically, everything can be controlled by annotations, which is a very generic pattern that is used, you know, it's kind of a GWT idea, and we definitely wanted to keep that through, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. But back to just highlighting a couple of these different sections. So if we take a look at this particular list grid in this modal here, you can see that now I am able to select a row directly. And if I do so, it just switches over to this other tab. And I can fill in this form, and we can see that it's here. And so I'll just go ahead and add another one real quick so we can have two here. And now you can see that these records are ones that we would select, right? So it's the same list grid. It's just depending on the type of the list grid, we have different functionality that's available. So for example, the cross-sale products collection has a concept of being ordered, and you can easily reorder the grids. And we'll cover this again in a little bit, but just wanted to point out the interaction is pretty nice. You know, the rows move as you're dragging them, pretty responsive. It anchors back whenever you let go. And that's something that might seem hard, but as we'll show, it was really pretty simple. One other thing to show in the UI is our rich text editor, and this is going to be, you know, a comparison with the GWT one that we had a little bit of a pain point that we'll talk about. And that was that the GWT one was a little bit hard to extend, whereas this one, it was pretty easy to just add in a custom button that drove a specific Broadleaf interaction. And so the last touch point that I wanted to cover in our demo here was just the speed of development that we have. And so if we look at this advanced tab, you can see that the model is the last thing in this window. And if we switch over to my IDE, I'm just going to uncomment this annotation here for our product attributes. And you can see that with just three lines of code here, we're going to be able to automatically get a list grid to manage those product attributes as soon as I refresh the page. And you can see that it only took about 5 seconds to see that change. And now we have this fully featured list grid where you can select rows, you can get all this edit functionality automatically just by using some annotations. And that's one of the goals that we were striving for when moving away from GWT, was bring everything to a more consistent, generic way so that people that are utilizing Broadleaf have an easier time adding functionality. So there were a lot of factors that motivated us to move away from GWT, but at the same time, GWT is not all bad, and there were a lot of things that we wanted to ensure that we had. So again, just to reiterate, I'm not saying that nobody should use GWT or anything like that, just that for our situation, it made sense to switch our app over. That being said, ThoughtWorks TechRadar does have a hold status on GWT since March of 2012. So again, you know, these are all things that we were considering when making the decision to move towards Spring MVC. So the last, you know, overarching consideration that I want to cover before we dive into some details is that we didn't migrate just out of our desire to migrate to GWT. There was a lot of, you know, pressure from our community users, developers that are using our software that were having a hard time customizing the GWT code. They're not necessarily GWT developers. They had a hard time diving into our admin architecture to customize it in the way that they wanted. And so another thing that was a, you know, rationale for us moving away from GWT was to make that experience better for our end users. So diving into some details here, our GWT builds were slow. It was taking about 4 minutes per build. And that's on my development machine, which is a pretty decent Core i7 machine. You know, the GWT compiling permutation step was what took quite a bit of time. And whenever we were making modifications outside of development mode, you know, the rebuild cycle was pretty lengthy. When we were using the GWT hosted development mode, our live modification was still pretty slow. The initial page load after you have the GWT hosted mode always took a pretty long time, up to several minutes. Sometimes it worked. Sometimes I would make a change and, you know, I wouldn't see the result that I expected to see in the hosted mode. And then that, of course, would make me have to shut down my server, do a full rebuild, start it up again. Working with the GWT hosted mode plugin for Firefox used to be annoying too. There were, you know, every time that Firefox would update its version, I would have to go track down in some Google groups where the guy responsible for creating that plugin would post the new version. And as Firefox is starting to release, you know, versions much more quickly, that was really, you know, becoming a bit of a pain. Lastly, there's just as you're developing in GWT, I found that there's a lot of interesting features in GWT, like not being able to use java.util.calendar. So this is a bug that's been opened in 2007, and it's still unreleased. And sure, once you know that you're not allowed to use java.util.calendar, it's okay, and you don't use it, you use a different implementation for dates, and you're on your way. But just that initial cycle of learning that you can't use java.util.calendar is a little bit painful. And we've seen instances of that a few times where we can't really trace the issue that we're having, and then it ends up being a problem with GWT itself. So that's just contributing to the slow development cycle that we had. Making server-side calls just as a result of a button press wasn't trivial, right? So you have to create your interface that's going to extend this remote service GWT interface with your method, right? And then you're going to have to create another interface that's the async one that provides the callback so that you can use it in your presenter, right? So then you'll need some boilerplate code here to kind of hook up a entry point to this interface that you've created, and GWT will proxy that. Of course, then you're going to need to use your function here and provide the callback, and this is something you would do in a presenter. Then, of course, you provide your implementation. Don't forget to hook up your URL mapping. So it's just quite a lot of boilerplate to do for something that should be pretty simple, right? I just want to trigger some server-side action when I press a button. It's just something that should be extremely easy and quick to do that, you know, until you're extremely familiar with GWT, you won't be able to do it quickly. And even when you are, there's still quite a lot of boilerplate effort that is involved in hooking up all those actions. So this is a quote from Steve Jobs. This is from the 80s, and he's referencing the boot-up time of the Mac OS at that time. And what he's basically getting to is, you know, if you as a developer have the opportunity to do something that's going to save a lot of people a little time, it can definitely be worth it. And so, you know, doing the math for us, if you're only doing 2 builds per day, and each build takes an extra 3 minutes than what it potentially could take, and your team has 10 developers, that's almost 300 hours per year. So that's a good amount of time that you're spending just building software and waiting for it to compile, whereas you could be, you know, productively using that time. And this is actually the time that it takes to build a demo site using the old Broadleaf. So it's not that we're just saving our development team that amount of time. We're actually saving time for anybody that would be using this framework and was having to compile GWT over and over. So we had some difficulty fine-tuning GWT. So it's expected that you're going to lose some control whenever you're using a language that's going to compile to other languages, right? So GWT is you're writing code in Java, and it's compiling it to CSS, HTML, and JavaScript. So you're not going to get full control of what gets generated, typically. You have to rely on components and themes that other people have built, UI that other people have decided that this is how this particular widget is going to look like, and you kind of just roll with it. Whenever you do want to modify something, it can get pretty hairy, right? So have you written any native methods in Java lately. I certainly haven't, and this kind of code isn't something that you're used to writing as a developer, right? This is a little bit more specialized knowledge that takes a little bit of time to get up to speed with. The UI is written in swing style UI code, right? You've got your classes and you're kind of hooking stuff up, you're setting some widths. It's pretty unintuitive way to build a web app, where most people that are familiar with building web apps would prefer to use HTML and CSS and JavaScript to have things positioned and behave exactly how they're expecting it to behave for their app. We also felt that, you know, the available themes in GWT are kind of dated. And these are some smart GWT widgets, which we were definitely using smart GWT in addition to GWT for our old admin. And you can just kind of see that some of these themes, you know, they just don't look that great. They certainly don't give off the feeling of a modern web app. Even though GWT is supposed to be cross-browser, we've run into issues where certain things didn't play very nicely. And so this is from the people that actually developed Smart GWT, their examples page. So you can see on the right where the dropdown for skin, where simplicity is chosen, the dropdown is not rendering properly. The scroll bar just above it isn't rendering properly. And for some reason, it's not stretching to my browser size perfectly. So I have a scroll bar both horizontally and vertically. And to try to dive into those things, it's pretty difficult. I mean, these are some of our earlier versions of our admin, and you can see that the widgets that we're using are pretty similar to what I showed you before from the isomorphic website. And any change that we tried to make to these widgets was pretty difficult. It was pretty time intensive, hard to track down. I mean, you're trying to modify CSS files inside of jars, and it's just hard to locate what you're looking for and configure them. So there's quite a bit of time involved in figuring out exactly where to go to fine-tune some things. Now, with all that said, we don't think that GWT is necessarily bad. There are definitely a lot of things that we liked about GWT that we wanted to leverage in our new application. So one of those things is kind of abstracted UI. That was pretty nice. You don't have to have super deep knowledge of HTML, CSS, and JavaScript to use GWT. In fact, you don't need to know HTML, CSS, and JavaScript at all. You can rely on the extensive widget library provided by GWT to kind of mix and match functionality that you're requiring for your library. You don't have to necessarily worry about cross-browser compatibility very much. That's supposed to be GWT's responsibility. And the vast majority of the time, it does a great job at making things look the same across all different browsers. And certainly, the idea of leveraging UI elements as Java objects is pretty nice. It's a good idea. We absolutely wanted to think about presenting a list grid as this list grid is going to render a certain set of data, right? A certain set of strings. It's not so much this list grid is responsible for rendering cross-sale products sub-collection. Having that kind of layer in between your actual persisted object and what properties you're going to be editing, that's a really nice abstraction that we liked and wanted to provide for our users. So there's a lot of benefits in addition to just, you know, simplifying the UI that you get from being able to edit objects as kind of properties, right, instead of the actual object. So let's think of, if we think about the products list grid that I showed in the demo, the first column was the product name, and the second column was the default category name. So we're able to just say, hey, when I'm displaying a list grid for products, the fields that I want are product and default category.name. And so then we don't have to worry about having any type of weird, you know, object mapping issues. We just load the properties that are requested, and that's what the list grid is going to render every time. You can think about injecting additional properties. So one of our Broadleaf modules is the ability to have custom fields. So you saw in that product attributes map that I showed towards the very end that we had that heat range field, and it had a value. And so the custom field module that we have allows you to have heat range treated as a first-class citizen on product. So you set up that initial mapping saying, yes, I want to see the heat range field on product as a first-class citizen. And then we can pull that value out of the map and place it directly on the form. So our entity form follows a very similar approach to the list grid, where you can it's just rendering, you know, a set of properties. And so it's nice to be able to do that kind of thing. It's nice to be able to do that kind of thing instead of trying to have very, you know, one-off screens for every different entity. We're trying to have a more generic way of thinking about widgets and widgets just representing data, and then an additional mapping layer that takes a product object and converts it to the list of properties that should be rendered. So our new approach, of course, utilizes Spring Web-MVC, and this was a pretty easy choice for us to make. We're already a platform that's built directly on top of Spring. Our front end, meaning, you know, the actual site that you would build with Broadleaf, where a user would browse for products and add to cart and check out, that was already using Spring MVC to handle that. So it just kind of made sense to convert the admin as well. It's all Spring MVC is something that's more familiar to developers that use our framework. It's much easier to customize and extend GWT, and the learning ramp-up is much easier for new developers. They don't have to go and learn about GWT, which is a pretty different way of solving problems than, you know, using a controller, an MVC framework like Spring Web MVC, in addition to HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. Our templating layer utilizes Thymeleaf. JSP is pretty old, and there's a lot of better templating languages out there. And Thymeleaf is definitely one of the ones that we like the most. It's a very extensible language. Anytime that Thymeleaf makes a decision that we want to handle a little bit differently, since we are a framework and we're not just building a website directly on top of Thymeleaf, we're trying to build a framework so that other people can build websites on top of us. Sometimes we need a little bit more of a hook inside our libraries than you might otherwise need. And Thymeleaf is great about exposing tons of different configuration points and the ability to override a lot of functionality with your implementations of some of their interfaces. And it's just, you know, a real pleasure to work with. It's very nice. And, of course, the additional bonus is that we're already using this for our front end. So, again, it made it a pretty easy choice to pick Thymeleaf as our templating engine for the admin, just to be consistent in our entire architecture. You go and you learn Thymeleaf's templating syntax once to build your site, and now you need to make some customizations to the admin. Well, I mean, it's great because you already know all of the tools that you need to know to be able to do so. So since we are replacing GWT, which was kind of a full stack, right? There's some other components that we had to think about. We went with Foundation by Zurb for our CSS framework. It's very, very similar to Bootstrap, and it was great. It led us to only have to spend less than 5 hours on IE8 compatibility, which is awesome. I really dislike starting up my Windows VM and having to go and trace down, Internet Explorer bugs, and I barely had to do that at all. So that's definitely something that you want to consider if you're attempting to move away from GWT to a different stack that's a little bit more, it's not overarching like GWT is. Absolutely want to rely on a CSS framework to help you not have to worry about things like if I float this div, did I forget to clear it properly, and is that way compatible with all the browsers that I'm trying to support? It's nice to be able to push off as much of that kind of boilerplate work to the libraries that you're using instead of having to worry about that yourself. We made heavy usage of jQuery and some plugins, especially mCustom Scrollbar and Redactor. Redactor is the rich text edit that I showed you. mCustom Scrollbar is what we're using for scrolling our list grids. So with that said, most of our widgets are custom built, right? We're replacing GWT's widget library with our own, and we have some very specific goals for what we want our widgets to be able to do. And we decided to go with an approach where we rely on certain frameworks to help us out in building these widgets, but we still wanted to control the end result. And so that's where these other components come into play. So what did switching away from GWT get us? Well, our builds are much, much faster. We're down to under 30 seconds for a typical build. Our development cycle is much faster, too. You saw my change to that annotation in product that caused the map to be rendered on the screen, and how it, you know, it was about a 5-second refresh cycle. With Jarable, it's very, very easy. Almost all changes that aren't, you know, XML changes that need to be handled at startup are done pretty much immediately. You get to use the tools that you want. If you want to use your IDE to debug some Java code, well, you're free to do so, right? If you want to debug your JavaScript with Firebug, have at it. If you want to debug your JavaScript through IntelliJ's JavaScript debugging support, you can do that too. When you're not married to a technology that tries to handle absolutely everything for you, you have a lot more freedom to use the tools that best suit your workflow and best suit the problems that you're trying to solve. Also, going along the lines of a fast development cycle, right, you're not necessarily having to learn anything new. So some, you know, very, very simple JavaScript if you want to bind a button to do some action on the server side, right? So here we're taking a sub list grid add button. We're binding a click event on that button to do an AJAX get to some URL and then do something with the data. This is the kind of stuff that you're already going to be familiar with since you're building your site in these same technology stacks. So when you need to add an action to the admin, having that consistency really, really helps speed up your development cycle. It's much easier to fine-tune everything, right? So you're not dependent on themes and widgets that other people have written, and where other people have written a front-end component to the widget that you're trying to use as well, right? You can fine-tune exactly what you need to solve the problem that you have, and you end up with HTML, CSS, and JavaScript that looks like you want it to look like and is causing the page to be rendered how you want that page to be rendered. When you need to extend some functionality of a plugin that you're using, oftentimes there's not, you know, a perfect hook point for what you want to do. But in the JavaScript and jQuery ecosystem, tons of stuff is MIT licensed. So it's really easy to just go and dig into the guts of the code of the plugin that you're trying to use and make whatever tweaks you need to. You don't have to worry about figuring out how I'm going to write a native Java method to figure out how certain Java objects should be rendered in JavaScript through the whole GWT plumbing. So let's talk about actually building one of these list grids, right? So there are a lot of requirements that the GWT list grid provided that were really nice that we didn't want to lose. So we've got being able to select rows, and that needs to be dynamic, right? We looked at how clicking on a certain row for a list grid is going to trigger different actions depending on the type of the list grid. We need to be able to reorder rows. That's a pretty important from a business user perspective that wants their products to show up in the order that they want their products to show up. So we absolutely needed to support that. Column resizing is pretty basic functionality, but important. dynamic range loading, which I did not mention in the, which I didn't show in the demo, but I will when we get to this topic, was pretty neat. Filtering and sorting, pretty basic. You know, I showed that in the demo as well. So let's look at selecting rows, right? So there's a lot of JavaScript here, but it's really pretty simple. If we're just looking at all of these lines, we're assembling data from the current row that's selected, and we're doing that inside this click handler for a list grid table row. And we're pulling the list grid type, as you can see, and then that trigger line is an interesting one. So here's where we're getting that dynamic nature, right? We have our trigger for a list grid row selected, and we want to be able to handle that in different ways depending on the list grid type. So we want this, you know, basic boilerplate at the top here for all of them, and then we want to delegate this to a handler that's going to better know how to handle that specific type. So if we look at an inline row selected list grid, you're going to see that we have, you know, some steps to grab the data, figure out whether or not that row is currently selected, and then toggling that selected class on that row if it's not. And so that class is what was adding that background color to give the users a visual indication of the row being selected. And so this method, you know, it wouldn't be list, so the list grid inline row selected trigger is responsible for this, whereas the one that I showed you in the modal would in fact, you know, store off which row was selected and show that second tab. And then the last step here would be to update the toolbar action buttons for that particular list grid. And so, you know, when you don't have any rows selected, you don't necessarily want to show the edit button as an available action, because it doesn't make sense to edit something that, until you have selected a row. And so once the row is selected, you want to reflect that button state. And so, you know, sometimes some of these things would be handled for you in GWT plugins that you'd be using. Sometimes not. You know, you might need to enable and disable buttons yourself in GWT, but often a lot of these things are kind of handled for you. So that's the trade-off, right? You are giving up some of this UI functionality already being done for you through the GWT widgets, and you're trading that for more fine-grained control, right? So I'm okay with having to figure out what my button states should be. That's not a big deal for us, right? But maybe you're relying on some widget library that does something that's extremely complex, and that's something that you're going to need to consider when you're thinking about moving away from GWT to see if it's a worthwhile trade-off for your particular case. So reordering rows is really interesting. So I expected, when I first started looking at this problem, to have that it was going to take a while, right? It seemed pretty tricky that I was going to have to figure out, you know, binding the drag events and letting you move around the row as you'd like to, and then figuring out when the user dropped the row and doing all that, but I really didn't need to. And so one of the things that might surprise you if you're a heavy GWT user and you're thinking about moving away into more, you know, just straight-up JavaScript land, is you'll see that there's a lot of plugins for JavaScript and jQuery that help you out when you're trying to do these neat, rich events for the client-side application. And so simply by saying, you know, I have a given table body JavaScript object, simply by calling sortable on that table body, those two words alone will let me drag rows on the table up and down. And jQuery, this plugin will go ahead and move the DOM around and do all of that for me. And it provides this callback that I can provide for the update function that it will fire whenever somebody lets go of a row. And so all we need to do there is grab that row's, some data about that row. You know, since we're thinking about everything being generic in our list grids, right? We're not necessarily thinking of the cross-sale products list grid. We're thinking of any list grid that's marked as reorderable in the annotation can have this functionality. So we're just pulling some basic information there doing a simple jQuery post with the new index of that function, and then we handle it on the server side. So again, we have very generic methods, right? Section key, ID, collection field, collection item ID, sequence. And you post some data to that URL, right? So you've gone and you've marked in your custom entity, you've marked it as sortable. And so now you automatically get this controller functionality. You don't have to worry about writing it yourself because we did it in a generic way instead of trying to code, you know, a specific reorder function for a single scenario. The more abstract you can be with your UI when you're trying to replace GWT, which is based on widgets, you're going to have a better time doing it that way, I think, than when you're trying to just code everything in kind of one-offs. And that's a benefit of having an app that you've already built in GWT that you're trying to port over, is you've already kind of structured your app and thought about it that way in, you know, how am I going to just use a widget, and then I'm going to assemble widgets to make my screen look the way that I want it to. So you kind of think about the same thing when you're moving to Spring MVC, is what kind of widgets am I going to need, what widgets am I going to need to build, and how am I going to do all of that so that I can convert my application easily. So you're not always going to find a plugin that's going to help you out a lot, right? So sometimes you're going to need to build something specifically for your scenario. So our list grids, because we wanted the body to scroll independently of the head, that's kind of a drawback of just normal HTML tables. So there wasn't really a good column resizing plugin that we could use that would work with our pretty custom approach for how we were rendering that. So this is a scenario where we had to build it ourselves. And, you know, it might sound hard, but when you can use any resource available to you. So I found a pretty good Stack Overflow article where somebody asked about column resizing, and somebody said, oh, yeah, it's pretty easy, right? You just need to figure out where the mouse was in pixels when they started clicking and holding, and then figure out where they dropped the mouse at. And then you can, you know, do some math to figure out how much bigger you should make the column, make sure that they're not trying to resize it to a negative width or, you know, greater than the width of the table. So it's something that seems kind of hard, but it really wasn't. You know, this was something that I built in an evening, some Googling around and how to utilize certain features of jQuery made it pretty easy, right? So dynamic range loading. So I want to kind of just demonstrate this so you can have a better idea of how it works. And my session timed out, so I'm just going to log in again. So, all right, you can see here that the scroll bar for this list grid is pretty big, and it corresponds to how many records the server responded were the total records. So you can see at the bottom here that there's 330 records, and most of them are just dummy records that I inserted for the purposes of this demo to kind of just show the scrolling functionality. And basically what we're doing is, you know, you don't want, if you have a million products, you don't want to load all million products at once. You want to paginate it. But you don't necessarily want to make the user have to click next and back. So, you know, this is similar to the list grid functionality in GWT, and that we wanted to port it over because we did like it. And so if you scroll here to a range, you can see how there weren't records, and then records suddenly appeared. We can do that again. So you can see that we're loading another chunk of records, right? And the reason that it just says name here is, again, this is all just dummy data. But you can see that you can get some pretty nice functionality, right? And this is something that GWT provided that we wanted to port over. And this one was a little bit tricky. There's quite a lot going on there. You need to, you know, have, first of all, you have to make the list grid have the height that you would expect it to have if it had all the ranges loaded. Maybe you have, you know, you're looking at records 100 through 200, and you have 100 above that, so you need to have, like, some placeholder info above it. But, you know, it's just like solving any other problem. You're building this functionality for your widget, and once you build it once, you're going to be able to leverage it everywhere. You can leverage it in the main list grid. You can leverage it in the sub-collection list grids, as long as you're kind of taking the more modular, I'm building a widget approach. So another thing that I wanted to touch on here is event debouncing. So this is some of the, you know, this is kind of going along the lines of things that are handled for you in GWT, but are things that you might need to consider when you're porting your application over. So as the user scrolls, you know, you don't want to trigger an AJAX call at every single pixel that the user scrolled. And if they scroll and they stop and then they start scrolling again really quickly, you might not want to load that range either. So that's kind of, you know, going along the lines of having really fine-grained control of all your widgets. That's going to be something that you'll need to play around with, right? Do you want to make the user stop scrolling for 100 milliseconds and then you can do your fetch for more data? Maybe it makes more sense to wait 200 milliseconds. So that kind of abstraction is something that's provided for you when you're using GWT widgets, but it's something that you're going to have to think about when you're trying to replicate them yourself. You have to go, you know, full scale across your architecture. This dynamic range loading has, you know, HTML, CSS, heavy JavaScript, and heavy server-side components that you'll need to write to replicate this feature. So that's something that you have to judge and determine if building out all this rich AJAX-ness that you get from GWT, and if that's going to be worth it for you when you're migrating. And maybe it's not worth it, and it's a really important feature for you, so you stay on GWT. We made a decision to go ahead and move away from GWT, knowing that we were going to have to handle some of these cases, and we're okay with that. So the main thing that I want to mention about filtering and sorting, I think it's pretty simple. But again, things that GWT handles for you that you have to handle yourself, history, right? We didn't want to break back button compatibility. It's really annoying as a user to go and say you filter for something and now you're at a page that has filtered results in your list grid. So you click on one of those results and then you go, you do something with that page, and then you click back. And you'd expect to see the filtered list. So we wanted to make sure that we are staying as true as possible to the state that the user sees when they're navigating pages with their browser back and forward buttons. So whenever we filter a list grid, which is an AJAX action, we're using the HTML5 history API to update the URL to take into account those filters. And so if the user were to go refresh that page or hit their back button to that page or even bookmark that page, they could get to that page with their filters already active. So that's an important thing when you're really building any web app, but especially when you're trying to move a web app that already handles this kind of stuff for you. It's just good to be aware of these considerations when you're writing your app. Okay, so let's just talk about some of the interesting Spring MVC things that we encountered. This webinar here was a presentation by Rosin Stoyanchev at Spring 1 2GX 2012. And it is a great webinar showcasing all of the new Spring MVC 3.2 features. I definitely encourage you to go watch that presentation if you're interested in having an in-depth look at Spring 3.2. But I did want to call attention to one new feature that I think, you know, I haven't seen too much documentation on, you know, from just people utilizing this feature, but the ability to map app path variable to a map. That's awesome. That was really what enabled our controller inheritance hierarchy. And so what I mean by that is our admin basic entity controller, it is responsible for handling all requests that start with slash and then, you know, curly brace section key. And so this method that I'm showing here just kind of shows what that request mapping is, but really the section key bit is at the class level. So what this does is you don't have to map for this method. You don't have to map the section key path variable directly to a string. Instead, you can map all these path variables to a map. And then you can have a method that will, by default, just pull out the section key variable from that map. And so that makes it easy to write one generic controller that handles, you know, all of our possible sections, whether you're managing a product or a category or some entity that you created that's not a part of Broadleaf. It'll all be managed by this basic entity controller. But when you have something special, so say that there's one collection inside a product that needs special attention. You can create a class that extends this controller, and instead of being mapped to a curly brace section key, you can map it directly to slash product, for example. And then with your get section key method, you can override that in your inherited controller and just return the string product. You don't have to have a successful binding from Spring for that section key variable, which it would fail. And so what's really nice about that is you're able to, if you need special support for one particular item or one particular element in the admin, you can extend our controller and be able to just override one method. Controller inheritance is usually tricky, but we think that, you know, it definitely wouldn't have been possible to get something as clean as we have now without being able to bind path variable to a map. So that's a lesser known feature that we think is pretty awesome. And the last thing that I wanted to talk about today is dynamically generating JavaScript resources. So to set up the problem, we have a class that basically supports the ability to have extensible enums, and you declare the members of that enum with that first block of code, right? So we're creating two different inventory types, none and basic. And what we need in the front end of the admin is the JSON structure that you see in the second block there. And we need this for a rule builder that we're using, and we're leveraging a plugin to give us our rule builders, and it's expecting a JSON structure similar to this. So our options were, well, we can go ahead and manually copy and paste these enum values into this JavaScript file, which is obviously not great. Another common strategy is, say you were using JSPs, you might create, you know, rule builder options js.jsp, and then whenever a request for that JavaScript file is handled, it's going to go through the entire, you know, processing chain, whether using JSP or Thymeleaf or any templating language. It's going to have to go through that hierarchy to build out your JavaScript file. Well, turns out that there's a lesser known approach that's pretty awesome. So if you've used MVC colon resources before to kind of take things outside of the annotation-driven controllers that are bound to you by Spring, that's setting up basically a resource HTTP request handler. And what we've done here is subclass that with our special one, and we give this class, you know, just the basic locations for our JavaScript files. And that's another point. Even with MVC resources, that location parameter, it actually is a comma-separated list of multiple locations. So that's another little lesser-known thing. But, you know, you create your own custom resource handler here, and then you set it up. This is the other half of what MVC resources does for you, is it will bind a certain mapping, URL mapping, to your handler. And so we're doing that here. There's nothing special going on. We're just, you know, making sure that we're setting the value to a number that's going to take precedence over the annotation-driven controller's order. And so what does that request handler look like? Well, it's pretty simple, right? So this is obviously not what we have in our code. We have a bit more of a generic approach, but the core is right there. You're matching to see if, oh, you're looking for this rule builder options.js resource. Well, I know that I can handle that in a special way. So I'm going to invoke this other method. And it will go and maybe it creates an in-memory resource, right? You have the structure that we have is we have all of the enums that we want available in this JavaScript file. We have those configured, and so what our generator does is it creates a resource, and then it will go and use reflection to look through those enumerations and assemble the JSON structure that we need. And so I think the key takeaway from this is there's often a ton of really neat hooks that Spring and Spring MVC provide that let you solve a lot of problems that you might have really elegantly. And the code is really well written. You can usually dive in and just kind of see what's going on, the Spring code, I mean. You can usually dive in, see what's going on. Sometimes people will have answers for you in Google. So I just really want to encourage you that if you have some pretty, you know, specialized requirement for something that you're trying to accomplish in Spring and Spring MVC is to just, you know, do some basic Googling and figure out where the, you know, the nice extension point is going to be. And you can usually solve problems pretty elegantly. All right, so thank you very much. If you're interested in trying Broadleaf yourself, you can visit that URL. That's a link to our Getting Started documentation. And we run through how to set up your own Broadleaf instance locally and get it running to play around with. And so now I'd like to open it up for questions.
All right, everybody, thank you for joining. This is Brad Buell with Broadleaf Commerce. We are going to open up the Q&A. So if you'll type any questions that you've got into your chat bar, we'd appreciate it. We've got a few, or rather a couple offline that we'll start with, and then one from previous question from the session. So first of all, Andre, generic question, was it worth it moving from GWT to Spring MVC?
And yeah, I think it was definitely worth it for our situation. You know, we were wanting to make a change that the community was going to approve, make Broadleaf more accessible to developers that maybe aren't intimately familiar with GWT, and having the admin written in GWT was a barrier for them. We wanted to eliminate that barrier and make it easier to use Broadleaf. And then, of course, we got all the other benefits that we spent today talking about, especially the development velocity. We're finding that even our GWT experts are really liking the new way that our new admin that uses Spring MVC. They're able to, you know, solve their problems more easily, and they're finding that, you know, learning a little bit of JavaScript here and there really isn't so bad.
Great. The second question is more on the general category as well, on why did Broadleaf choose Thymeleaf with other products that are out there in the marketplace?
Yeah, and there's a lot of different approaches that we could have taken there. You know, there's other templating languages that we could have chosen on the server side. And so things like, you know, just like JSP and Thymeleaf, there's velocity. There's a lot of different templating languages. And just to kind of, you know, reinforce that consistent architecture between our site and our admin was one of our main motivators. We had already picked Thymeleaf for our site because we like it a lot. It has all those extension points. It's fast. There's a lot of excellent internationalization support. And so we were already pretty sold on Thymeleaf just from using it in our site. We liked it a lot. And so it was a pretty easy decision to use it in Broadleaf as well. And then there are other frameworks that we could have used, right? More of the client-side MVC frameworks like Angular or Knockout. And so we definitely considered those, and we're still, you know, those aren't mutually exclusive with Thymeleaf. In this iteration of the admin, we're not using any of those client-side JavaScript frameworks to facilitate these interactions, but it's definitely something that we might consider for future versions of the admin.
Great. The next question comes from earlier in the session. The question is, does ListGrid support paging for large data sets? The example is 500,000 rows. I answered yes earlier and thought you might have a more detailed explanation, Andre.
Yeah, so you might have seen, you know, at the beginning I forgot to do that in the initial demo, the dynamic range loading. But I'm pretty sure that I answered your question a little bit later on in the presentation, likely after you answered it. But we showed that dynamic range loading where we're only fetching a certain, you know, amount of rows that's configurable with some property files. And so we load, you know, a given set, and we have the ability to page data in that way. We don't actually have, you know, you clicking next and next and next to get to different pages. We tried to, you know, mimic the GWT list grid a little bit more closely to provide that scrolling pagination.
Great. The next question is regarding GWT. So just a question generally, if you have any thoughts on GWT's future in general, given that Google's support of Dart and their move to turn GWT over to a steering committee rather than have it more internally.
Yeah, so I don't know that I can comment too much on the future of GWT, seeing as I don't, you know, work at Google. I do know that they have a new version of GWT coming out where they're going to address several bugs. Hopefully they fix that six-year-old calendar issue. And I've also heard talk about GWT wanting to marry a little bit closer to Dart as well for their version 3.0. Now, with that said, you know, the ThoughtWorks technology radar has had GWT as a hold, which means that they don't encourage new adoption of it. That was back in March of 2012. Subsequent technology radars don't even have GWT on them anymore. Whether or not that will change when 3.0 comes out, I don't know. But I guess the key takeaway is if I were going to be building an app in the future, I probably wouldn't use GWT. But that's not to say that it's not the right solution for your particular problem.
Great. Next question is more along the lines of technology. Have you considered Vaden? If so, what's the reason to not use Vaden if you did consider it?
I'm actually not familiar with Vaden, so I will write that down as a note for me to research. And if it's applicable for us, there's definitely a potential opportunity to integrate with that.
Great. Next question, more on the Spring MVC side. Does Spring MVC have Google Map API support?
Have what? Excuse me?
Google Map API support.
I'm not sure on that. We've actually not integrated with Google Maps, but it would not surprise me if Spring did. They have, tons and tons of plugins, especially around social things. I'm sure that, with a little bit of research, you'll find somebody that has run into issues, or not issues, but has run into that problem of using the Google Map API with a Spring app, as it is a really popular framework. And you could probably find some information on the web about that.
Great. Next question is, your custom-built widget, especially the custom list grid, is useful. Is it available for other people to use?
So the short answer is not at the moment. We did build it quite generically in that, it expects just some properties that have some special, markers for this is a record that points to another record, right? So like the category example, or this is just a string record. And so the way that we built our list grid is it's really coupled to some classes that we have in Broadleaf. It's coupled with the UI that we wrote for it that utilizes Thymeleaf. And then there's some server-side components, of course, like to support the pagination. And there's the JavaScript components to drive the scrolling, the filtering, the reordering, all of that. So it really is a very integral part. It's very tightly integrated with our admin. That's not to say that, we don't externalize it in the future. And there's, certainly a possibility, one of our future roadmap items might be to provide the admin as a standalone thing that you could just plug in this admin to your Hibernate classes and manage your entities, whether or not you're developing an e-commerce framework. So at that point, you'd have access to that list grid. But at the moment, it really is too tightly coupled for us to separate it and distribute it standalone.
Thank you. Next question is, let's see here. Did you use any JavaScript MVC frameworks within the web browser?
Yeah, so we didn't. I talked about using Angular or Knockout or something like that. That was as an alternative to Thymeleaf. And it's not something that we've, said we're not going to do that. It's just something that we didn't do in this particular iteration. We were under, a bit of time pressure to re-architect our admin here, and none of the developers on our team were intimately familiar with those JavaScript MVC frameworks, so we didn't choose to use one. But that, again, is not to say that, future iterations of Broadleaf, as we're improving on the admin, maybe it does make sense to add this additional piece. There's a lot of considerations for us there as well, because now we're requiring developers to learn that framework as well if they're trying to mess with the admin. So it's not just the fact that we would have to learn it. It would be, a little bit more of a widespread problem, just kind of similar to requiring developers to learn GWT to customize the admin. We wanted to really consolidate our stack into Spring Web-MVC, Thymeleaf, jQuery, right? So that's the stack that we were kind of going for, just to provide a more consistent basis for any developer that is already comfortable with those technologies to be able to modify and utilize both the Broadleaf front end as well as the back end.
Great. Next question is specific to the technology. How easy is it to build data grid, cell table, using renderer, bind data, et cetera, compared to GWT?
Yeah, so I think the question, and please clarify in the chat if I'm interpreting it wrong, but I think the question was how easy was it to build, this list grid widget? And it wasn't particularly hard, but it was a bit time intensive, right? The GWT, especially the smart GWT list grid, it really does provide a lot of functionality. A lot of people have spent a lot of time writing, some pretty nice, rich client-side JavaScript interaction. And mimicking that with the tweaks that we wanted to provide wasn't necessarily hard, but it definitely did take a bit of time. It was one of the more intensive efforts in our project just because we do have support for so many different types of collections, and the types of list grid that we have are a lot. So we have support for basic collections, collections of other Hibernate entities. We have support for maps. There's quite a bit going on there. And so a wholesale replacement of the list grid, while not necessarily hard, each piece was pretty straightforward. It did take quite a bit of time. And the only other consideration there is that, our list grid, I think we feel, is a little bit richer than the smart GWT one in terms of it doing exactly what we needed it to do. So some of that time wasn't necessarily porting functionality, but rethinking about how we wanted to handle certain elements and writing the code to support that.
Great. Next question is, did you use GWT Racket Factory, Requit Factory? I'm probably getting that wrong before moving.
So I'm not familiar with that technology. I know that we did utilize Smart GWT as our main kind of GWT enhancer, and that provided us a lot of benefits in that, the Smart GWT widgets were a little bit more full-featured than just the raw GWT widgets. But there's also some downsides, right? When you're relying on one particular widget provider and they don't have one of the widgets that you want, you run into a little bit of an issue with having UIs rendered by different people and different themes for these UIs, and then you try to have a smart GWT widget next to a GWT widget or a smart GWT button next to a GWT button, and you get some UI inconsistencies there. And that was one of the main motivators for us to kind of build our widgets ourselves, was to have that fine-grained control of what everything is going to look like so that we can present a consistent and, attractive admin UI.
Andre, this is Peter speaking. I think there's a typo there, and it's GWT Request Factory. I don't know if that changes your answer or not, but just thought I'd let you know.
Gotcha. Yeah. So the GWT Request Factory, again, I'm not super familiar with that. I wasn't responsible for the initial architecting of the GWT solution. So a lot of the time that I've spent in GWT was adding, some functionality here or there. And that sounds like it's something more in the guts of GWT. So the answer is I don't think we use that, but I'm not 100% sure.
Got it. Andre and Brad, would you mind if I very quickly address that Spring MVC Google Maps question super quick?
Sure.
Absolutely.
Thanks. Yeah. So if you're still on the line, gentleman that asked that, Spring MVC doesn't do anything in particular to support Google Maps API. We neither help nor hinder. It's just sort of orthogonal. You can certainly use them together. There's no like wrapper classes or anything like that we're putting around Google Maps API. You can integrate them just fine. We're not doing anything in particular to help or hinder that. So thanks, guys, for letting me jump in on that one.
Sure. Thanks for clarifying that.
All right. Next question is, so do you see improvements performance-wise when you move to Spring MVC plus Thymeleaf, considering one of the best features of GWT is compiled JavaScript? I do know that we've had an increase in development velocity, and we have some other fun stories internally about, refactoring advanced search, having, the GW code taken out, and the engineer that was working on that actually approached our president and said, I took all the GWT code out, and there's nothing left. So, Andre, I don't know if you want to you know, clarify that a bit more.
Yeah, sure. We definitely saw, you know, lots of improvement in development velocity, kind of like I talked about earlier and Brad just mentioned. But yeah, we actually are seeing, you know, much faster performance on just utilizing the admin as well. You know, we have a client that was using the admin, and their internal network has some kind of ridiculous safeguards on what goes through. And they know that whenever they hit the page initially and their firewall is trying to inspect the contents of, you know, this five megabyte JavaScript file that GWT generated, their initial page loads are taking 5 minutes, which is ridiculous, right? It should take a second. And then actually using GWT, sure, it's pretty quick, right? They have that nice, they serialize all that stuff for you and submit it with AJAX requests. So it's not that our old admin wasn't slow, but I wouldn't say that it was super responsive and snappy either, despite GWT's best efforts. A lot of times we would be, you know, dealing with an entity that has links to a lot of other entities. Like if you have an order item, right, or an order. So an order has a customer and it has an order item. An order item is associated with a product and kind of, you know, a pretty big hierarchy. And so GWT, we had to, you know, hit the inspect phase for all of those classes whenever we were trying to present something like that. So we were seeing, you know, several second page loads when switching to a new tab. We have definitely seen improved performance with Spring MVC and Thymeleaf. We've spent a little bit of time. We're still in beta for 3.0, and towards the, you know, tail end of just last week, we started hooking up your kit profiler and taking a look at some of the requests and how long things were taking. And we're at sub-second page loads for almost, you know, every action that we're trying to take. And that's the only thing that we did to achieve that was basically turn on some caching inside of Thymeleaf for some of the messages, for the internationalized messages and template resolving. So we definitely saw a pretty significant user performance experience by moving away from GWT. That might vary if you have like a really small, entity structure, a smaller GWT app, it's probably really responsive for you. And then, you have to have some pretty optimized AJAX requests to mimic that in Spring MVC. But I think that for our application, which was probably a bit of a heavier, on the heavier side of GWT applications, we saw an absolute definite performance improvement with Spring MVC and Thymeleaf.
And kind of on the tail end of that question, Andre, you mentioned caching. Another question, are we using any in-memory cache API?
Yeah, we use EHCache as our provider. So that's, you know, what Hibernate is going to use for its query caches and its own entity caches. And we kind of piggyback on that EHCache for explicitly caching things that we want cached. So I can give you an example. We're still going through, some inspection and reflection phases when we're assembling the view for this app, since we are driving everything via those admin presentation annotations that I quickly showed, kind of reading and parsing all of that is a little bit, time intensive. And so one of our optimization steps that it's coming up here is going to be to let all that happen once and then cache that result, utilize it in the future. And so EHCache is the in-memory cache provider that we utilize at Broadleaf.
Great. Next question, and this is really one for Spring MVC, but love to get your thoughts on it. Andre, in regards of vulnerabilities issues, is Spring MVC secured? The answer is yes, but I'd like to get your clarifying statement on that one.
Yeah, and I actually do have something I'd like to mention on that note. Spring MVC, and we're using Spring Security to handle kind of our authentication. It's great. It's, you know, I would go as far as to say it's almost the industry standard for securing Java applications. We do a couple of special things. So, the Thymeleaf, I've mentioned that it's very customizable, right? So the forms that we use in Thymeleaf, by utilizing a processor in Thymeleaf, we automatically inject a CSRF token into the form, and then we hook up a Spring Security filter to check every single form that is posted to the server to make sure that it has that CSRF token and it matches what the value that we're expecting. So the answer is yes, Spring MVC is definitely very secure, but just because, but it's not going to give you, 100% coverage of the OWASP top 10. There's still going to be some stuff that you're going to need to do in your application to make sure that whenever you're parsing input and rendering that to the client or submitting forms that you're validating against CSRF, protecting against cross-site scripting. So the Spring security framework is excellent, but you still do need to consider security yourself as well.
Couldn't have said it better myself, Andre. Thanks.
Next question is, since you're using Spring MVC, are you also using STS IDE or another such as IntelliJ? Are there significant motivations for one IDE versus another for development of your framework? I know it's kind of getting into developer religion question, but let's take it over, Andre.
Yeah, and I'm very opinionated on that. We have a lot of different people that use different things at Broadleaf. I'm a fan of Eclipse. So that's what I use, and I like lighter weight IDEs, so I don't actually have the STS plugin installed on my machine, but I know that some of the other developers do utilize that and enjoy it quite a bit. Our lead architect uses IntelliJ, so there's, quite a bit of, freedom to use whatever you're most comfortable with.
Yeah, Andre, I think you said that really well before in the presentation. Is that there is a freedom for the IDE tools. We think STS provides a lot of value, of course, Spring Tool Suite, but you're not soldered to it in any way. And you want to use IntelliJ or you want to use Sublime Editor or Emacs or whatever. You're more than that's what we think is part of the strength of Spring, is that it's tooling agnostic.
Thank you, Peter. I've got one more question in the forums. So given your statements about potentially adding a JavaScript NBX framework in the future, how would that impact Thymeleaf as a server-side template framework?
Right, and that's a fantastic question. That's actually, the main reason that we haven't implemented that already is it does make it very difficult to rely on Thymeleaf to render some stuff and then rely on, a JavaScript MVC library to render other stuff. So that is a pretty tricky question to answer, and it's definitely one of the reasons that we haven't moved to one of those yet. I think that the approach that we would probably take would have to be kind of on a case-by-case basis. So when you're thinking about a list grid, we really need Thymeleaf to render that list grid initially and set up all that plumbing for us. But when we're updating that list grid as a result of, a user typing in something and hitting OK, those updates we could probably, handle with something like Knockout or AngularJS. And that's just, a bit of a different architecture than we have in place right now. It would probably make the app a little bit faster, more responsive. It might clean up quite a bit of, the JavaScript that we've written, but it might also complicate other things and having, two different paths to get data to the user.
Great. Well, that's all the questions that we've got today. Thank you all for staying on and running longer. Thank you very much to SpringSource for the opportunity to present here. This does conclude the session. If you have further questions, you can send them to info@broadleafcommerce.com. Again, info@broadleafcommerce.com. You can always check us out on the web as well at www.broadleafcommerce.com or broadleafcommerce.org for the more developer-centric site. Peter, Amy, thank you very much.
Thanks, everyone.